greet you in the name of Christ as we are gathered online to worship. Today, the parable of the wicked tenants of the vineyard is what I'll be preaching on, and really it just highlights a time of tension in the life of Jesus and the people of God at that time. And I'm just going to say we live in tense times today as well. So it's good for us to be here in worship, hearing God's word to us. And I'll turn it over to Pastor Chris.
Greetings in the name of the Lord. It's, as always, a pleasure to be worshiping God, whether it's in person or online. And we continue this practice of offering both as we continue to, as Randy talks about, and during these times that we're living in, working through what it means to be church during COVID. So we worship as we have been for the last several months from Lutheran Service Book, page 203, setting 4. You can also download the bulletin from the church website. So we worship today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sin, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church in which you daily and richly forgive our sins, grant us new life through your Spirit, be in our midst, enliven our faith, graciously receive our prayers and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We continue our worship with our opening hymn, number 804, O Worship the King. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Oh,
the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. To God on high be glory and peace to all the earth. Goodwill from God in heaven proclaimed at Jesus' birth. We praise and bless you, Father, your holy name we sing. Our thanks for your great glory, Lord God, our heavenly King. To you also be God and the Father, Son, we pray. O Lamb of God, our Savior, you take our sins away. Have mercy on us, Jesus, receive our heartfelt cry. Where you in power are seated at God's right hand on high. For you alone are holy, you only are the Lord. Forever and forever be worshipped and adored. You with the Holy Spirit alone are Lord most high. In God the Father's glory, amen, our glad reply.
The Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
We pray together. Gracious God, you gave your Son into the hands of sinful men who killed him. Forgive us when we reject your unfailing love and grant us the fullness of your salvation. We pray through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it, cleared it of stones, and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it, and he looked for it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done for it? When I looked for it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And I will tell you what I will do with my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its walls, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and briars and thorns shall grow up. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant planting. And he looked for justice, but behold, bloodshed; for righteousness, but behold, an outcry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is from Psalm 80, verses 7 through 19. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine, that we may be saved. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, It took deep root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. It set out its branches to the sea, and its shoots to the river. Why then have you broken down its walls, so that all who pass along the way pluck its fruit? The boar from the harvest ravages it, and all that move in the field feed on it. Turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. Have regard for this vine, the stock that your right hand planted, and for the son whom you made strong for yourself. They have burned it with fire. They have cut it down. May they perish at the rebuke of your face. But let your hand be on the man of your right hand, the son of man, whom you have made strong for yourself. Then we shall not turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call upon your name. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Let your face shine, that we may be saved.
The epistle reading today is from the letter to the Philippians, chapter 3, 4b to 14. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness, under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, but they did the same to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance.' And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
All right, boys and girls, this is the time when we have the children's sermon. So if you were here, you'd come forward, but you're not. So come forward closer to the TV, and I'm going to get something. I'm going to just put it behind my back. Boys and girls, what do you do if there ever comes a time when you're maybe a little bit scared or afraid of something? What is the answer to help you not be so afraid? Well, I have it right here, and the answer is candy. Chocolate will do it every single time. If you're afraid, all you have to do is eat some M&Ms and everything will be fine. Now, you know I'm joking, boys and girls. Candy's good, but it's not going to keep you from being afraid or do any of those things. But some people kind of think that way. I just want you to know we've got something better. We have our Lord Jesus. And when we're afraid or when we're troubled in any way, we can pray to him. And he's put people in our lives, like our parents and brothers and sisters and other people like that, to help us so that we cannot be afraid or worried or anxious about so many things. So if you were here, I'd give you a piece of candy just because I could. But you may have to ask your parents for that. Thank you, boys and girls. And we will continue our worship with the next song.
I believe in the risen one. I believe I am a God.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The sermon text is the reading from Matthew that has already been read. And boy, that reading talks about a time of a lot of stress and anxiety. Jesus against the chief priests and the Pharisees. By the way, there was some good stress too. People were excited. Jesus had rode into town on Palm Sunday. This is Holy Week. And just wanted you to know, there was a lot going on, and a lot of it was anxious and stressful. Well, we are no strangers to that. Right now, we live in anxious times. I have a friend who says that before COVID, normally people functioned at a level 2 of anxiety, 1 to 10, and it goes up and down from there. But he says right now everybody is starting at least at a 5, and it's going up and down. And that's, boy, you see that all kinds of stuff. As the weeks and months of this pandemic go on, you notice things, you know? People are a little bit short with each other. People are worried. People are asking, when will this be over? People are sick and tired of being sick and tired. So, what do we do with all this tension and anxiety? Well, it's interesting, in Jesus' day, they were ready to turn it into violence. Let's arrest this Jesus guy. But they were worried and fearful about the crowds. They were worried about crowds in those days, too. All I'm saying is some people turn anxiety into violence. You've seen it in families, marriages, where people are kind of turning on each other. Do you know the people who keep track of these things have said abuse of children and spouses has gone up during the pandemic? And of course, that's an awful thing to do with anxiety, but we see it happening today. A lot of people internalize their anxiety and it becomes depression. Depression has always been a problem in this world, but it's even more so now. And psychiatrists and therapists have to do a lot of their work online, and I tell you, they don't like that, but that's what they have to do. And they are noticing more and more people want their services, and they're having to turn them down because they want to take care of themselves. We who follow Jesus know that, 1 Peter says, cast all your anxieties on Jesus because he cares for you. But I will simply say that is easier said than done. It's hard to take the anxieties we have and give them over to Jesus. Some feed their addictions when they're stressful. That's why in my children's sermon I had the chocolate candy. You know, I have a feeling. And I don't know about you, I've gone to the stores. Man, Halloween candy is just through the roof in all these stores. And people probably aren't even giving it out this year because of the pandemic. I guess people are just taking chocolate home and are going to use it. When the pandemic first broke out, there was one city in Texas that decided they were going to close their liquor stores because that was not an essential service. Well, they were to close. The lines were out the door. They had to rethink their decision. I'm just saying that some people deal with anxiety by feeding their addictions. And again, not a good plan. For many of us, though, it's just a quiet storm. People are noticing little things wrong with their health. You know, their stomach is upset, or their knee hurts, or more headaches than normal. And people aren't sleeping well. And I think all of us find it harder just day to day to get along. There is this overarching and ongoing anxiety. One Christian author I read says that we should take a 2-month fast from watching any news and spend our time in prayer and service, because all that increases our anxiety. And it's good for us to know what is going on in our world so we can pray about those things, but sometimes even that is too much. I will say on the positive side, there are some people who have taken this pandemic and thrived and learned new things and are seizing opportunities that weren't there before, and I say, great, And I hope all of you have experienced something like that. But we all need encouragement during these very hard times. Now, I bring all this up because, like I said at the beginning of the sermon, Jesus was experiencing a time where there was a lot of turmoil and stress and tension around him. He had come in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. He was teaching in the temple, and the chief priests and the elders of the people and the Pharisees were very upset by Jesus coming into town, clearing the temple, all the things he had done. And Jesus was telling stories. And just like last week's story, this week's story is a story about a vineyard. And that's always code word for God's people. If you listen to the Old Testament today and the Psalm today, you realize how important this was in the lives of those people. So Jesus told a parable that is often, as Jesus' parables are, unthinkable. Tenants who were supposed to be producing grapes and giving, you know, a good percentage of the profits to the person who owns the vineyard, instead take the servants and beat them up and stone them and kill them. And even the son, I'm not sure what their thinking is, but they say, well, if we kill the son, if he sent the son, the master must be dead. So if we kill him, it'll all be ours. So let's kill him. And again, for people in that day, they would just find that kind of behavior unthinkable. And even the chief priests and the Pharisees, when Jesus said, what do you think the owner should do? And they said, get rid of the tenants. Get new ones who are going to give the fruit to the person to whom it's owed. But they quickly realize Jesus is telling this parable about them. And it's interesting. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, those three Gospels all include this parable. John kind of goes a different way, but the fact that all those Gospels include this parable tells me it's significant. It is meaningful and memorable. And as parable goes, it's actually pretty easy to interpret. A vineyard, well-kept, protected, equipped by a landlord, an owner who is away, asked the tenants to raise the crop, and again, they mistreat all the servants who come, and when the son comes, they kill him out of the vineyard, and it's pretty basic what the parable is. The vineyard is God's people. It always is. And the owner is God, and the son is Jesus, whom the religious leaders of Jesus' day rejected. And Jesus kind of foreshadows his own killing. It's interesting that he says the murder happened outside of the vineyard because Jesus was crucified outside the city walls of Jerusalem. So they realize, wow, he's telling this parable against us. There is a lot at stake. I am guessing that if you were in the room at the time, the tension, you could probably cut it with a knife because it was so real. And the leaders decided, well, there's only one way to deal with this. And they were going to do the violence. They were going to take Jesus' life. And it's a sad reality of this broken and this fallen world that people respond to things like stress with violence and bloodshed. Now, as we look at this parable, it's good for us to know that Jesus did not return violence with violence. He came to defeat sin and death and all of that violence. And his method of conquering death was to go through it, to endure it, to suffer it. And even the violence of this anxious time was included in and overcome by the power and love of Jesus. So the question is always, when we look at ancient parables like this one, what does it say to us in 2020? Now, of course, we see this parable as having been fulfilled in Jesus. It was a story Jesus told that indeed happened. God had provided everything for his people, his vineyard, protection, love, care. He had sent prophets to do course corrections, and they had been rejected. And finally, God sends his own son. And Jesus also is met with rejection. We can see that these leaders of God's people, and this happened in the Church of Jesus, were replaced. Gentiles and others became the leaders of the new Church of Jesus Christ. So new tenants, new people were brought in to be God's people. But where do we fit into this parable? You can say, well, I wasn't there. You know, I didn't reject Jesus. I didn't crucify Jesus. But there's an interesting verse. It's in the book of Hebrews, of all places, chapter 6, verse 6. And this verse tells us that as we live lives in rejection of Jesus and our sinfulness in all those ways, this passage says that we are crucifying Jesus anew. One of our great hymns, Jesus, I Will Ponder Now. We sing it every Lent. But, you know, there's a verse in that hymn where we pray, Lord, may I not crucify you anew by my unholy living. And so I'm just going to say we can take our place in that parable as well. Sometimes we reject Jesus, his love and care for us. So we're there. You know, we're always looking at the parables and saying, where do I belong? But I would further say this. We are also the beneficiaries of the blessings in this parable. God continues to provide for his vineyard. And you know, that today is us. God continues to bless all of creation. God continues to bless his church with faithful people. God continues to give us the means to produce fruit in keeping with repentance and love for God. And when we look at that parable of the son who was sent to his death, we know that that was Jesus who did that for us. Passing through death, suffering on our behalf, and rising from the dead. So yes, we're stressed by COVID. There's a lot of uncertainty. People get sick and die. But for us who follow Jesus, there is good news. We shall not die, but live. You know, we hear it every Sunday. Every Sunday is a little Easter. And Jesus, who endured the stress of the cross, also promises, come to me, all you who are heavy laden, stressed out. And he says, I will give you rest. That's a promise that we can trust. Now, there are no easy answers for the stresses of this time and day. But we who rely on Jesus also rely on his grace to see us through. He suffered for us. He died for us. He lives for us. And we are connected to him. In John 15, Jesus takes up really the whole imagery of God providing for the vineyard and you know, the production of grapes and all that stuff. And he makes it personal. He says, I am the vine. You are the branches. We are organically and intimately connected to Jesus. His life runs through us. And that is comfort. Even during these anxious times, the life of Jesus flows through us. God still equips us to bear fruit in this world, in whatever way we can. Jesus also said one other thing in that time where he said, I am the vine and you are the branches. He said, in this world you will have trouble. He said it 2,000 years ago. It's just as true then. It was true then. It's true today. But then he says, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. That is good news for us, even in this anxious and stressed and messed up world. He is with us. We are connected to him. He has overcome even this. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We now profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We continue our worship with our prayers. I'm thankful for all that God is doing in and among us, and I'm excited about some of the opportunities moving forward, especially as we continue to implement the reopening plan in October for the church, and also as we remain mindful that everybody's kind of at a different place right now as we do that. So, but we celebrate and we cry together, we pray together, we celebrate together, and we come to prayer together as well. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray to you, thanking you for, in these difficult times, in these challenging times, also giving us reason for hope and encouragement. We pray first, Lord, for the suffering, especially those that we name aloud, Larry Sparks, Bob Andrus, Risa Hedge, Cindy Stewart, Jason Lawley, and those that we name in our hearts. We pray for their healing during this time. We pray for comfort for those who have suffered loss, especially naming the family of Jenny Wilcox on the death of her sister. Lord, in the midst of these losses, we ask for your peace. We pray with all of those that are mourning during this time, and especially those that are having to be limited in how they can reach out and comfort those loved ones because of the restrictions of COVID. We also pray, Lord, for Thanksgiving, for birth, for a new life, for Carson Scott, born to Jonathan, Amanda, O'Reilly, and for the O'Reilly family. We pray for the parents, the grandparents, and all involved in that celebration. Lord, as we come to your table to receive the very body and blood of your Lord Jesus, of our Lord Jesus, we pray that it will grant us pardon, peace, and strengthen us. God, as we continue to work through this pandemic, this COVID, we lift up in prayers those who suffer. We pray for all who have the disease and many loved ones, Lord. We pray for the leaders of our country, for the President, the First Lady, who have this now, and many others who are in positions of leadership. We pray, Lord, for those that are isolated during this time. We pray that you will grant strength and compassion for those who are suffering for any reason due to COVID, especially those that continue to struggle financially and those that have businesses that are impacted by this as well. We pray for our friends. We pray for our leaders to make wise decisions during this time. We pray for Bethel, Lord, as it is making decisions, trying to put together a ministry plan and a budget and all the things that go into these unknowns into this next year. We pray, Lord, that you will give us strength, wisdom, and humility. We pray that a vaccine will be found soon. We pray for a cure. We pray for an end to COVID. We pray for an end to racism and all the things that create divisions in our society and in our churches and even in our own families. We thank you, God, that you continue to strengthen us every day. We thank you for our friends and our family that are there with us during these difficult times. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. We continue our worship with the gathering of our tithes and our offerings. We do thank you all who are giving in the many different ways that are made available to you. We also thanks that those that are able to come back and enjoy worship in person. And encourage you to continue to tithe and make your offerings to Bethel, whether it be online or through the mail or in person. So we thank you for your continuing support of Bethel and our ministries. We continue with the worship of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy God, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who out of love for his fallen creation humbled himself by taking on the form of a servant, becoming unto death, even death on a cross. Risen from the dead, he has freed us from eternal death and given us life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, taught by you, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. It was our Lord Jesus Christ on the night of his betrayal, took the bread from that Passover meal. He broke it. He gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup. Having given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant of my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you eat and drink this in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Take and eat, take and drink the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now may the eating and drinking of Christ's very own body and blood strengthen and preserve you this day forward. Depart in his peace. Amen. We pray together. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that out of your mercy, you would strengthen us through this same faith towards you in fervent love towards one another through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us then bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Receive the blessing of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor, giving you his peace.
Amen.
Amen.
We continue with our closing song.
And today is the first Sunday of the month, and we are trying to get back to our communication update once a month, and I am going to do that for you today. During these COVID days, we have had to make many adjustments, and thank you for making your feelings known through the survey. Well over 100 people completed the survey, and two things became clear. One is that we need to continue our online presence. Many people are appreciative, so we will certainly do so. Also, many people are not yet ready to venture out and to come into a public place, and we respect that, and we pray for the day when we can all get out again as we used to. The other thing that came out of the survey was that many people desire an early traditional worship service. So, I am announcing today that on October 18th, 2 weeks from this weekend, God willing, we will have two Sunday services, one traditional at 8:30, and after cleaning and preparation, a second service at 10:30 a.m. We will continue our online presence using these services, and will no longer have a recording on Saturdays as things stand now. The praise band will be involved in the late service. We ask you to pray for this transition to go smoothly, and for those who come to live worship, we ask that you continue to follow the protocols of self-screening, wearing masks, hand sanitizing, social distancing, and encouragement of others. Our capital fund initiative has been postponed by COVID with the extra time. We have found out that there is more we can do to enhance our sanctuary and not just replace the flooring. A detailed proposal will be brought to the Voters Assembly in November, and we are knowing that your generosity will overflow. Our Early Learning Center continues a great ministry to families in our neighborhood, and their board of directors is active. COVID has presented challenges, but Takanya Spencer, our director, and our staff have met these challenges in safe yet robust ways. In terms of youth and children, a lot has had to be postponed, but service opportunities and safe gatherings have continued. We continue to serve our community. Volunteers have assisted White Rock Center of Hope. We provided lunch for our Highland Meadows Elementary School teachers, and school supplies were given in a drive-by fashion to over 100 students. Our Spanish worship and Kenya Rwandan worship, still vital parts of Bethel, continue every Sunday live as well. Bethel has held its own financially, But income is running at about 90% of what we expected. And I noticed that even in the survey, there were a number of people who have not been able to give for whatever reason. I'm not sure why. I'm sure COVID has had an impact. Rest assured that the council is on top of the situation. And this is Stewardship Month, so we will encourage you to respond generously as we look to plan our ministry for 2021. And speaking of ministry in 2021, there will be changes, and there is one I specifically need to announce. Kathy and I have decided that it is time to retire from ministry at Bethel. It will have been 35 years next February since I was installed at Bethel. It has been a blessed time of ministry, but it is time to retire. I will continue to serve until next summer, and no doubt God has plans for us. But this announcement comes now to give the congregation time to plan for its future. A transition team is already in place, and the church council has been aware for a while of this decision. It is not taken lightly. I personally think Bethel is in a good place for new leadership to thrive. By the way, Pastor Chris has asked not to be considered for the position of the next senior pastor of Bethel, but he is most willing to see the congregation through this transition. As always, God will be with us. That's a lot of news. The Lord of the church is always in charge and with us always. Blessings to you in every way.